Status. To ensure execution of the treaty's terms, Allied troops would occupy the left, German, bank of the Rhine for a period of 5 to 15 years. The German army was to be limited to 100,000 officers and men. The general staff was to be dissolved. Vast quantities of war material were to be handed over and the manufacture of munitions rigidly curtailed. The navy was to be similarly reduced, and no military aircraft were allowed. Germany was also required to pay reparations for all civilian damage caused during the war. Weimar Republic, 1919-1933 overview. The humiliating peace terms in the Treaty of Versailles provoked bitter indignation throughout Germany, and seriously weakened the new democratic regime. In December 1918, the Communist Party of Germany, KPD, was founded, and in 1919 it tried and failed to overthrow the new republic. Adolf Hitler in 1919 took control of the new National Socialist German Workers' Party, NSDAP, which failed in coup in Munich in 1923. Both parties, as well as parties supporting the republic, built militant auxiliaries that engaged in increasingly violent street battles. Electoral support for both parties increased after 1929 as a Great Depression hit the economy hard, producing many unemployed men who became available for the paramilitary units. The Nazis, formerly the German Workers' Party, with mostly rural and lower middle class base, overthrew the Weimar regime and ruled Germany in 1933-1945. The early years. On August 11, 1919, the Weimar Constitution came into effect, with Friedrich Ebert as first president. On December 30, 1918, the Communist Party of Germany was founded by the Spartacus League, who had split from the Social Democratic Party during the war. It was headed by Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht, and rejected the parliamentary system. In 1920, about 300,000 members from the Independent Social Democratic Party of Germany joined the party, transforming it into mass organization. The Communist Party had following of about 10% of the electorate. In the first months of 1920, the Reichswehr was to be reduced to 100,000 men, in accordance with the Treaty of Versailles. This included the dissolution of many Freikorps, units made up of volunteers. In an attempt at coup d'état in March 1920, the Kapp Putsch, extreme right-wing politician Wolfgang Kapp let Freikorps soldiers march on Berlin and proclaimed himself Chancellor of the Reich. After 4 days the coup d'état collapsed, due to popular opposition and lack of support by the civil servants and the officers. Other cities were shaken by strikes and rebellions, which were bloodily suppressed. Germany was the first state to establish diplomatic relations with the new Soviet Union. Under the Treaty of Rapallo, Germany accorded the Soviet Union de jure recognition, and the two signatories mutually cancelled all pre-war debts and renounced war claims. When Germany defaulted on its reparation payments, French and Belgian troops occupied the heavily industrialized Ruhr district, January 1923. The German government encouraged the population of the Ruhr to passive resistance. Shops would not sell goods to the foreign soldiers, coal miners would not dig for the foreign troops, trams in which members of the occupation army had taken seat would be left abandoned in the middle of the street. The passive resistance proved effective, insofar as the occupation became loss-making deal for the French government. But the Ruhr fight also led to hyperinflation, and many who lost all their fortune would become bitter enemies of the Weimar Republic, and voters of the anti-democratic right. See 1920s German inflation. In September 1923, the deteriorating economic conditions led Chancellor Gustav Stresemann to call an end to the passive resistance in the Ruhr. In November, his government introduced new currency, the Rentenmark, later, Reichsmark, together with other measures to stop the hyperinflation. In the following 6 years the economic situation improved. In 1928, Germany's industrial production even regained the pre-war levels of 1913. The national elections of 1924 led to swing to the right. Field Marshal Paul von Hindenburg was elected president in 1925. In October 1925 the Treaty of Locarno was signed by Germany, France, Belgium, Britain and Italy. It recognized Germany's borders with France and Belgium. Moreover, Britain, Italy and Belgium undertook to assist France in the case that German troops marched into the demilitarized Rhineland. Locarno paved the way for Germany's admission to the League of Nations in 1926. Reparations. The actual amount of reparations that Germany was obliged to pay out was not the 132 billion marks decided in the London Schedule of 1921, but rather the 50 million marks stipulated in the end bonds. Historian Sally Mark says the 112 billion marks in bonds were entirely chimerical, a device to fool the public into thinking Germany would pay much more. The actual total payout from 1920 to 1931, when payments were suspended indefinitely, was 20 billion German gold marks, worth about $5 billion or £1 billion British pounds. 12.5 billion was cash that came mostly from loans from New York bankers. The rest was goods like coal and chemicals, or from assets like railway equipment. The reparations bill was fixed in 1921 on the basis of German capacity to pay, not on the basis of Allied claims. The highly publicized rhetoric of 1919 about paying for all the damages and all the veterans' benefits was irrelevant for the total, but it did determine how the recipients spent their share. Germany owed reparations chiefly to France, Britain, Italy, and Belgium. The U.S. received $100 million. Economic collapse and political problems, 1929 to 1933. The Wall Street crash of 1929 marked the beginning of the worldwide Great Depression, which hit Germany as hard as any nation. In July 1931, the Darmstadter und Nationalbank, one of the biggest German banks, failed. In early 1932, the number of unemployed had soared to more than 6 million. On top of the collapsing economic and political crisis, the political parties represented in the Reichstag were unable to build governing majority in the face of escalating extremism from the far right, the Nazis, NSDAP. In March 1930, President Hindenburg appointed Heinrich Brüning Chancellor, invoking Article 48 of Weimar's constitution, which allowed him to override the parliament. To push through his package of austerity measures against majority of Social Democrats, Communists and the NSDAP, Nazis, Brüning made use of emergency decrees and dissolved parliament. In March and April 1932, Hindenburg was re-elected in the German presidential election of 1932. The Nazi Party was the largest party in the national elections of 1932. On July 31, 1932, it received 37.3% of the votes, and in the election on November 1932 it received less, but still the largest share, 33.1%, making it the biggest party in the Reichstag. The communist KPD came third, with 15%. Together, the anti-democratic parties of the far right were now able to hold considerable share of seats in parliament, but they were at sword's point with the political left, fighting it out in the streets. The Nazis were particularly successful among Protestants, among unemployed young voters, among the lower middle class in the cities and among the rural population. It was weakest in Catholic areas and in large cities. On January 30, 1933, pressured by former Chancellor Franz von Papen and other conservatives, President Hindenburg appointed Hitler as Chancellor. Science and culture. In 19th and 20th century, the Weimar years saw flowering of German science and high culture, before the Nazi regime, resulted in decline in the scientific and cultural life in Germany and forced many renowned scientists and writers to flee. German recipients dominated the Nobel Prizes in science. Germany dominated the world of physics before 1933, led by Hermann von Helmholtz, Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen, Albert Einstein, Otto Hahn, Max Planck and Werner Heisenberg. Chemistry likewise was dominated by German professors and researchers at the great chemical companies such as BASF and Bayer and persons like Justus von Liebig, Fritz Haber and Emil Fischer. Theoretical mathematicians Georg Cantor in the 19th century and David Hilbert in the 20th century. Carl Benz, the inventor of the automobile, and Rudolf Diesel were pivotal figures of engineering, and Werner von Braun, rocket engineer. Ferdinand Cohn, Robert Koch and Rudolf Virchow were three key figures in microbiology. Among the most important German writers were Thomas Mann, 1875-1955, Hermann Hesse, 1877-1962, and Bertolt Brecht, 1898-1956. The reactionary historian Oswald Spengler wrote The Decline of the West, 1918-23, on the inevitable decay of Western civilization, and influenced intellectuals in Germany such as Martin Heidegger, Max Scheler, and the Frankfurt School, as well as intellectuals around the world. After 1933, Nazi proponents of Aryan physics, led by the Nobel Prize winners Johannes Stark and Philipp Lennard, attacked Einstein's theory of relativity as a degenerate example of Jewish materialism in the realm of science. Many scientists and humanists emigrated. Einstein moved permanently to the U.S., but some of the others returned after 1945. Nazi Germany, 1933-1945. The Nazi regime restored economic prosperity and ended mass unemployment using heavy spending on the military, while suppressing labor unions and strikes. The return of prosperity gave the Nazi Party enormous popularity, with only minor, isolated and subsequently unsuccessful cases of resistance among the German population over the 12 years of rule. The Gestapo, secret police, under Heinrich Himmler destroyed the political opposition and persecuted the Jews, trying to force them into exile, while taking their property. The party took control of the courts, local government, and all civic organizations except the Protestant and Catholic churches. All expressions of public opinion were controlled by Hitler's propaganda minister, Joseph Goebbels, who made effective use of film, mass rallies, and Hitler's hypnotic speaking. The Nazi state idolized Hitler as its Führer, leader, putting all powers in his hands. Nazi propaganda centered on Hitler and was quite effective in creating what historians call the Hitler myth, that Hitler was all-wise and that any mistakes or failures by others would be corrected when brought to his attention. In fact, Hitler had narrow range of interests and decision-making was diffused among overlapping, feuding power centers. On some issues he was passive, simply assenting to pressures from whoever had his ear. All top officials reported to Hitler and followed his basic policies, but they had considerable autonomy on daily basis. Establishment of the Nazi regime. In order to secure majority for his Nazi party in the Reichstag, Hitler called for new elections. On the evening of February 27, 1933, the Reichstag building was set afire. Hitler swiftly blamed an alleged communist uprising, and convinced President Hindenburg to sign the Reichstag fire decree, which rescinded most German civil liberties, including rights of assembly and freedom of the press. The decree allowed the police to detain people indefinitely without charges or court order. 4,000 members of the Communist Party of Germany were arrested. Communist agitation was banned, but at this time not the Communist Party itself. Communists and socialists were brought into hastily prepared Nazi concentration camps such as Chemnitz concentration camp, where they were at the mercy of the Gestapo, the newly established secret police force. Communist Reichstag deputies were taken into protected custody, despite their constitutional privileges. Despite the terror and unprecedented propaganda, the last free general elections of March 1933, while resulting in 43.9%, failed to give the majority for the NSDAP as Hitler had hoped. Together with the German National People's Party, DNVP, however, he was able to form slim majority government. In March 1933, the Enabling Act, an amendment to the Weimar Constitution, passed in the Reichstag by vote of 444-94. To obtain the two-thirds majority needed to pass the bill, accommodations were made to the Catholic Center Party, and the Nazis used the provisions of the Reichstag fire decree to keep several social democratic deputies from attending, and the communists' deputies had already been banned. This amendment allowed Hitler and his cabinet to pass laws, even laws that violated the Constitution, without the consent of the President or the Reichstag. The Enabling Act formed the basis for the dictatorship, dissolution of the Länder. The trade unions and all political parties other than the Nazi Party were suppressed. Centralized totalitarian state was established, no longer based on the liberal Weimar Constitution. Germany left the League of Nations. The coalition parliament was rigged by defining the absence of arrested and murdered deputies as voluntary and therefore cause for their exclusion as willful absentees. Subsequently, in July the Center Party was voluntarily dissolved in quid pro quo with the Pope under the anti-communist Pope Pius XI for the Reichskonkordat. And by these maneuvers Hitler achieved movement of these Catholic voters into the Nazi Party and long-awaited international diplomatic acceptance of his regime. According to Professor de Geary, the Nazis gained larger share of their vote in Protestant areas than in Catholic areas, in the elections held between 1928 and November 1932. The Communist Party was proscribed in April 1933. Thereafter, the chief of staff of the SA, Ernst Röhm, demanded more political and military power for he and his men, which caused anxiety among military, industrial, and political leaders. In response, Hitler used the SS and Gestapo to purge the entire SA leadership, along with number of Hitler's political adversaries, such as Gregor Strasser and former Chancellor Kurt von Schleicher. It became known as the Night of the Long Knives and took place from June 30 to July 1934. As reward, the SS became an independent organization under the command of the Reichsführer SS Heinrich Himmler. He would rise to become chief of German police in June 1936 and already had control over the concentration camp system. Upon Hindenburg's death on August 1934, Hitler's cabinet passed law proclaiming the presidency to be vacant and transferred the role and powers of the head of state to Hitler as chancellor and Führer, leader. Anti-Semitism and the Holocaust. The Nazi regime was particularly hostile towards Jews, who became the target of unending anti-Semitic propaganda attacks. The Nazis attempted to convince the German people to view and treat Jews as subhumans, and immediately after winning almost 44% of parliamentary seats in the 1933 federal elections, the Nazis imposed nationwide boycott of Jewish businesses. In March 1933, the first official Nazi concentration camp was established at Dachau in Bavaria, and from 1933 to 1935 the Nazi regime consolidated their power. The law for the restoration of the professional civil service passed on April 1933, which forced all Jewish civil servants to retire from the legal profession and civil service. The Nuremberg Laws of 1935 banned sexual relations between Jews and Germans, and only those of German or related blood were eligible to be considered citizens. The remainder were classed as state subjects, without citizenship rights. This stripped Jews, Roma and others of their legal rights. Jews continued to suffer persecution under the Nazi regime, exemplified by the Kristallnacht pogrom of 1938, and about half of Germany's 500,000 Jews fled the country before 1939, after which escape became almost impossible. In 1941, the Nazi leadership decided to implement a plan that they called the Final Solution, which came to be known as the Holocaust. Under the plan, Jews and other lesser races, along with political opponents from Germany as well as occupied countries, were systematically murdered at murder sites, German concentration camps, and starting in 1942, at extermination camps. Between 1941 and 1945, Jews, Gypsies, Slavs, Communists, homosexuals, the mentally and physically disabled, and members of other groups were targeted and methodically murdered, the origin of the word genocide. In total, approximately 11 million people were killed during the Holocaust, including 1.1 million children. Military. In 1935, Hitler officially re-established the Luftwaffe, Air Force, and reintroduced universal military service. This was in breach of the Treaty of Versailles. Britain, France and Italy issued notes of protest. Hitler had the officers swear their personal allegiance to him. In 1936, German troops marched into the demilitarized Rhineland. As the territory was part of Germany, the British and French governments did not feel that attempting to enforce the treaty was worth the risk of war. The move strengthened Hitler's standing in Germany. His reputation swelled further with the 1936 Summer Olympics, which were held in the same year in Berlin, and proved another great propaganda success for the regime as orchestrated by master propagandist Joseph Goebbels. Women historians have paid special attention to the efforts by Nazi Germany to reverse the gains women made before 1933, especially in the relatively liberal Weimar Republic. It appears the role of women in Nazi Germany changed according to circumstances. Theoretically, the Nazis advocated patriarchal society in which the German woman would recognize that her world is her husband, her family, her children, and her home. However, before 1933, women played important roles in the Nazi organization and were allowed some autonomy to mobilize other women. After Hitler came to power in 1933, feminist groups were shut down or incorporated into the National Socialist Women's League, which coordinated groups throughout the country to promote feminine virtues, motherhood and household activities. Courses were offered on children rearing, sewing and cooking. The Nazi regime did promote liberal code of conduct regarding heterosexual relations among Germans and was sympathetic to women who bore children out of wedlock. The Lebensborn, Fountain of Life, Association, founded by Himmler in 1935, created a series of maternity homes where single mothers could be accommodated during their pregnancies. As Germany prepared for war, large numbers were incorporated into the public sector, and with the need for full mobilization of factories by 1943, all women under the age of 50 were required to register with the employment office for work assignments to help the war effort. Women's wages remained unequal and women were denied positions of leadership or control. In 1944-45, more than 500,000 women were volunteer uniformed auxiliaries in the German armed forces, Wehrmacht. About the same number served in civil aerial defense, 400,000 volunteered as nurses, and many more replaced drafted men in the wartime economy. In the Luftwaffe they served in auxiliary roles, helping to operate the anti-aircraft systems that shot down Allied bombers. Foreign policy. Hitler's diplomatic strategy in the 1930s was to make seemingly reasonable demands, threatening war if they were not met. When opponents tried to appease him, he accepted the gains that were offered, then went to the next target. That aggressive strategy worked as Germany pulled out of the League of Nations, 1933, rejected the Versailles Treaty and began to rearm, 1935, won back the Saar, 1935, remilitarized the Rhineland, 1936, formed an alliance, Axis, with Mussolini's Italy, 1936, sent massive military aid to Franco in the Spanish Civil War, 1936-39, annexed Austria, 1938, took over Czechoslovakia after the British and French appeasement of the Munich Agreement of 1938, formed peace pact with Joseph Stalin's Soviet Union in August 1939, and finally invaded Poland on September 1939. Britain and France declared war on Germany 2 days later, and World War II in Europe began. After establishing their own Berlin Axis with Benito Mussolini, and signing the Anti-Comintern Pact with Japan, which was joined by Italy a year later in 1937, Hitler felt able to take the offensive in foreign policy. On March 12, 1938, German troops marched into Austria, where an attempted Nazi coup had been unsuccessful in 1934. When Austrian-born Hitler entered Vienna, he was greeted by loud cheers. 4 weeks later, 99% of Austrians voted in favor of the annexation, Anschluss, of their country Austria to the German Reich. After Austria, Hitler turned to Czechoslovakia, where the 3.5 million strong Sudeten German minority was demanding equal rights and self-government. At the Munich Conference of September 1938, Hitler, the Italian leader Benito Mussolini, British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain and French Prime Minister Edouard Daladier agreed upon the cession of Sudeten territory to the German Reich by Czechoslovakia. Hitler thereupon declared that all of German Reich's territorial claims had been fulfilled. However, hardly 6 months after the Munich Agreement, in March 1939, Hitler used the smoldering quarrel between Slovaks and Czechs as pretext for taking over the rest of Czechoslovakia as the protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia. In the same month, he secured the return of Memel from Lithuania to Germany. Chamberlain was forced to acknowledge that his policy of appeasement towards Hitler had failed. World War II. At first, Germany was very successful in its military operations, including the invasions of Poland, 1939, Norway, 1940, the Low Countries, 1940, and France in 1940. The unexpectedly swift defeat of France resulted in an upswing in Hitler's popularity and an upsurge in war fever. Hitler made peace overtures to the new British leader Winston Churchill in July 1940, but Churchill remained dogged in his defiance. Churchill had major financial, military, and diplomatic help from President Franklin D. Roosevelt in the U.S. Hitler's emphasis on maintaining higher living standard postponed the full mobilization of the national economy until 1942. Germany's armed forces invaded the Soviet Union in June 1941, weeks behind schedule due to the invasion of Yugoslavia, but swept forward until they reached the gates of Moscow. The tide began to turn in December 1941, when the invasion of the Soviet Union hit determined resistance in the Battle of Moscow, and Hitler declared war on the United States in the wake of the Japanese Pearl Harbor attack. After surrender in North Africa and losing the Battle of Stalingrad in 1942-43, the Germans were forced into the defensive. By late 1944, the United States, Canada, France, and Great Britain were closing in on Germany in the west, while the Soviets were victoriously advancing in the east. Overy estimated in 2014 that in all about 353,000 civilians were killed by British and American strategic bombing of German cities, and 9 million left homeless. Nazi Germany collapsed as Berlin was taken by the Red Army in fight to the death on the city streets. Hitler committed suicide on April 30, 1945. The final German instrument of surrender was signed on May 1945. By September 1945, Nazi Germany and its Axis partners, Italy and Japan, had all been defeated, chiefly by the forces of the Soviet Union, the United States, and Great Britain. Much of Europe lay in ruins, over 60 million people worldwide had been killed, most of them civilians, including approximately 1 million Jews and 1 million non-Jews in what became known as the Holocaust. World War II resulted in the destruction of Germany's political and economic infrastructure and led directly to its partition, considerable loss of territory, especially in the East, and historical legacy of guilt and shame. Germany during the Cold War, 1945-1990, as consequence of the defeat of Nazi Germany in 1945 and the onset of the Cold War in 1947, the country was split between the two global blocs in the East and West, period known as the Division of Germany. Millions of refugees from Central and Eastern Europe moved west, most of them to West Germany. 2.